Thank you for the invitation. My apologies for not being here earlier on, but I'd like to, of course, thank the head of ESCAP Pacific Office, Mr. Mayaba, and of course the other panelists who are participating. Thank you very much for this opportunity. I would also like to, you know, I sat through the presentation, by Daniel Lee. Thank you for that too. It was very informative. But I think the 2021 survey is, of course, timely and highlights the recent macroeconomic progress of economies throughout the Asia-Pacific region. It details their diverse experiences with the pandemic and, of course, provides valuable policy lessons that, in fact, can be applied across the region to accelerate the post-pandemic recovery. Despite, of course, as seen in the report, the numerous challenges, we are pleased to know that the Asia-Pacific region was the most economically robust region in 2020. And that is poised to spearhead the global economic recovery in 2021. However, as has been seen, it must be noted that this recovery will be tempered somewhat by new infection waves, heightened lockdown restrictions in several countries. At the beginning of this year, we were already seeing that, and of course, possibly later on in the year. And of course, the emergence of the new and highly infectious strains of COVID-19. The SIDS, the PCIDS, of course, in particular, with the tourism-based economies in countries such as Fiji, to an extent, Vanuatu and Samoa, have experienced deep economic contractions in 2020, with only a modest recovery expected for 2021. The catastrophic economic implications of that crisis, in fact, has compounded the sluggish regional progress in implementing the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, further undermining development progress and exacerbating vulnerabilities to future shocks. As public revenues dry, and they dry up rapidly sometimes, amid weak tourism inflows and low aggregate demand, a severe fiscal constraints will make it difficult for governments to provide adequate resources towards achieving the 2030 Agenda. Here in Fiji, of course, we've been tirelessly working to contain a local outbreak of the new virulent B.1.6.1 variant. This is our first community outbreak in almost 12 months. It goes to show that you are never necessarily free from it, unless, of course, the entire world has the vaccination program rolled out. And we expect some setbacks to the domestic economic recovery as a result. Fortunately, around 56,000 Fijians, including frontline workers, have already received the first dose of the AstraZeneca vaccine. And more will be rolled out in the coming months. We are working very closely with our international partners to secure more vaccines. New Zealand has pledged to provide 500,000 doses, this will cover close to 250,000 Fijians, while Australia plans to provide about 10,000 doses next week. This will all go well for our vaccination program, which is critical for the reopening of our borders. We target to vaccinate around 650,000 Fijians that are 18 years and above. Overall, in the developing world, in the Asia-Pacific region, slow vaccination progress suggests that the economic threat of the pandemic may persist in the near term with negative ramifications for long-term growth. Unless immediate remedial actions are taken, the recovery will be likely K-shaped, as has been highlighted in the presentation by Desmond Lee, with non-privileged countries and more vulnerable groups being left behind. In order to reinvigorate tourism and economic activity, it is vital that non-privileged countries are given expeditious access to vaccines. In response to the pandemic, economies have provided swift and unprecedented fiscal stimulus, fueled by increased government borrowings, as has been highlighted also. In the case of Fiji, the closure of international borders has had a major impact on public revenue streams, forcing us to rely heavily on external borrowings from multilateral and bilateral partners in the last two budgets to finance the deficits. Despite huge reduction in government revenues, it was critical to maintain public spending to stimulate economic activity, ensure public services and social safety nets remain unaffected. Government spending is important during such crisis times. Otherwise, the adverse impact on the poor and vulnerable, as well as for the economy, would be much larger. However, Given the limited fiscal space in most developing countries, donor support and quality of spending will be in this area very, very critical. We are indeed very grateful to our lending partners, including the World Bank, the Asian Development Bank, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, and the Japan International Cooperation Agency specifically, for the invaluable funding support during these challenging times. We also thank our bilateral partners who scale up direct budget support funding during these tough times. As highlighted in the report, we agree that investments in social services and digital infrastructure is important to reducing inequality. Education and health feature prominently in the national budget in terms of resource allocation. Poverty alleviation and women advancement programs have also received continued support, although more will be required in these areas given the current development. The Fijian government, in partnership with the Fiji National Provident Fund, or FNPF as commonly known in Fiji, so far has paid a total of $286 million to support those that are currently unemployed or on reduced hours due to the pandemic. Of this, government has actually paid out about $158 million and around $128 million has been withdrawn from the FNPF members' general accounts. Over 100,000 Fijians have been assisted so far with this unemployment assistance scheme. To support those in the informal sector, government introduced the Stronger Together Job Support Scheme and the concessional loan facility for micro, small and medium enterprises. A total of 83 employers have been approved with around 1,362 jobs under the new Stronger Together Job Support Scheme. And over $30 million was disbursed to around 6,100 MSMEs in the agriculture, wholesale and retail, food and hospitality, transportation, manufacturing and other service-driven sectors under this concessional loan facility. The survey's reference to green policies to help address climate change is also welcome. Fiji, of course, as some of you do know, has been a champion on this issue and has advanced on this front by devising its green growth framework in the 2014 budget and, of course, put it together in the public space. In 2017, Fiji became the first emerging market to issue a green bond with proceeds channeled towards climate adaptation and building resilience projects. We are currently in discussions with one of our development partners, in particular the UK, regarding the issues of blue bonds, given the importance of our oceans to fight against climate change. And I note that the report presentation did not mention blue economies, but we think, as large as oceanic countries, the blue economy is critically important. In fact, perhaps some may argue even more important than the green economies. The challenge for small developing states like Fiji, of course, is that the large financing requirements to build resilience and infrastructure it needs to be made available, and of course, at rates that are attractive and indeed rates that are palatable for us. The recommendations around public debt management are also important. Fiji has already restructured some of its debt and opted for more external financing with longer term maturity and concessional terms to reduce debt servicing costs on going forward. The report's message on learning from past crises, of course, is noteworthy. Fiji has had a well-capitalized and profitable banking system and adequate foreign reserves when the crisis in fact began. This healthy position is a reflection of lessons from the past and has now helped us weather this storm much better. Despite losing our largest source of foreign exchange, which is tourism, we have managed to keep sufficient foreign reserves as well as liquidity in the banking system, both of which will be critical in economic recovery going forward. In particular, when you want the economy to jumpstart once we get over this the current situation that we're in. This is a time for tourism-dependent economies, of course, to also seriously consider diversification of their economic base to build resilience and, of course, defray their risks and also from future shocks. There's greater value addition in agriculture. And of course, the ability to expand into the manufacturing base as an alternative development of sectors within the economy. The 2021 survey also proposes other growth sectors that can be harnessed to expedite the post-COVID-19 recovery, including expanding healthcare, which is something that we are currently looking at and working on through a PPP, and social protection, closing the digital divide, improving energy efficiency, and building a climate-resilient infrastructure through, of course, a blue and green economy. Regional and multilateral cooperation is absolutely essential for building forward better together, because we'll be able to work together across the region in terms of building scalable projects, for example, in particular for adaptation measures. The full potential of fiscal and financing options can only be realized when the Asia-Pacific economies and international development partners work hand in hand. We also need the private sector, including the financial institutions and corporations, to step up and assist governments and development partners in building more resilient, sustainable, fair, green and blue economies. Finally, I'd like to also thank ESCAP for this report and the discussion, of course, will allow us to share experiences and learn from each other. Thank you very much.